Philippine inflation jumps to 3.7% in March. Oil firms implementing another big-time price hike next week. The MWSS begins reducing water pressure in Metro Manila amid the combined dry season and the El Nino phenomenon. And the Supreme Court allows even heinous crime convicts to earn reduced jail terms based on good behavior. We'll get a reaction on this from the president of the group Volunteers Against Crime and Corruption, Arsenio Boy Evangelista. I'm Stanley Palisada. Dateline Philippines begins right now. And for those of you watching us on YouTube and Facebook, glad you could join us. Our top story this hour, Philippine inflation quickens for a second straight month. The consumer price index jumped to 3.7% in March, up from February's 3.4%, but lower than last year's 7.6%. The uptick was mainly driven by faster increases in the prices of food, particularly rice and onions, as well as transport costs. It is also getting closer to the upper end of government's 2-4% target range for the year. The Philippine Central Bank warning inflation may temporarily go above government's target range in the coming quarters due to the impact of the El Nino phenomenon on agriculture. The BSP is widely expected to keep interest rates at a near 17-year high during their next policy meeting on Monday in a bid to keep inflation down. But an economist believes the fight against inflation goes beyond hiking rates.
Even if, you know, we push policy rates to 10%, but if your rice supply still looks like that, we'll never solve this issue. So I've always sort of echo what the BSP says, that yes, we're doing what we can now from this side, but they fully support the, you know, calls for the fiscal side to, you know, improve the supply situation, because that's the only way you really solve this issue. Once again, you can push rates to 10%, you can push rates to 20%, super restrictive. But if you don't fix your supply issues, then we're always going to see this inflation, you know, hound the Philippines. BSP was very clear that we're going to start to see like the brunt of those rate hikes hit this year. Yeah, so, you know, hopefully we do find space. I think the government said they're willing to spend a bit more this year just to support growth. But yeah, very challenging environment out there. You have the geopolitical concerns, local inflation, and of course, elevated borrowing costs and tight fiscal space. So many challenges that are likely to weigh on the growth momentum here.
The Philippines' top economist vows to address the effects of adverse weather conditions on prices following an uptick in inflation. NEDA Secretary Arsenio Balisacan says government is closely monitoring the effects of the ongoing El Nino phenomenon on the supply of key commodities. The weather event has cost over 2 billion pesos in crop damage to the Philippines. Balisacan adds preparations aimed at mitigating the effects of La Nina are also underway. The government has said La Nina might start in June, increasing the possibility of more storms ravaging the country by the last quarter of the year. Bad news for motorists. Another big-time oil price hike looms next week. Gasoline may increase by as much as 1 peso and 20 centavos per liter, while gasoline or kerosene prices may be higher by at least 1 peso and 10 centavos. Diesel prices, meanwhile, may see the biggest hike of as much as 1 peso and 40 centavos per liter. The expected pump price hikes could be attributed to fears of a wider conflict in the Middle East, as well as Ukraine's attack on Russia's oil refineries. A recent study found over half of Gen Z Filipinos are picking up multiple jobs. Andrea Taguinas tells us why in this report.
Hustle now, retire early. That's the main takeaway in a new study released by Philippine healthcare provider PhilCare. The study shows the Filipino Gen Z, or those born between 1997 and 2015, prefer getting as many gigs or sidelines as they can early on in their career to allow them to retire young. That's in contrast to how older generations prepare for retirement, which is by working in a traditional office setting while keeping their eyes peeled for potential business ventures in the long run. 53% of Gen Z said they prefer multiple part-time jobs over just one full-time work, compared to just 48% of Generations X and Y, or the so-called millennials. According to the lead researcher of the PhilCare Wellness Index, this can be attributed to several factors. For one, more Gen Z respondents said they feel the double burden of supporting themselves and their parents compared to the non-Gen Z.
Kung sino ang single, siya ang may, o pinaka-nakababata, siya yung may responsibility sa magulang. Kasi nga, may nuclear family na yung older. Ang priority nila, yung sarili nilang pamilya. If you feel the double burden, ang ginagawa nga ng mga Gen Z ngayon ay rumakit.
More Gen Z also want to set aside additional funds for leisure and actually make time for such recreational activities like traveling by going for jobs that have flexible work hours. Another distinction is that more Gen Z want to work abroad, while the mindset of older generations is to stay in the Philippines or return home if they have been working overseas.
Nakikita nila na kasinggaling naman sila nung sa ibang bansa, but hindi sila kapareho ng bayad. Kung ito yung kakayahan ko at nakikita ko yung mga kasabayan ko ay pareho naman kaming ginagawa, ba't ako magstay dito?
But will this automatically translate to a mass migration? Not necessarily.
Nawawala niya rin yung tinatawag na parang territoriality. Working abroad doesn't mean working abroad. Ang daming mga working students namin who are actually working abroad in the sense that they maintain social media accounts of restaurants in the U.S.
Meanwhile, one similarity that the study found among Gen X, Gen Y, and Gen Z is that they now put a higher premium on health benefits, which is likely a lesson learned from the COVID-19 pandemic. Paraga said this clamor for health benefits could also mean that there are still many Filipinos who are not insured. PhilCare Wellness Index Chairman Dr. Enrique Ona hopes the results of the study could lead to better policies and workplace arrangements for all generations of workers.
The government needs to create straightforward, effective programs that support a aging population, ensuring that they have safety nets and viable options to continue contributing to our economy if they so desire. Meanwhile, the private sector must stay attuned to the shifts in work culture, particularly the importance of work-life balance and personal time that are emphasized by the younger generations.
800 respondents nationwide were surveyed for the latest PhilCare Wellness Index. Andrea Taguines, ABS-CBN News.
Residents of Metro Manila facing less water supply this month. The Metropolitan Water Works and Sewerage System, or MWSSS, it has begun reducing water pressure in households and establishments in the capital region. But the agency clarifies for now, no water interruption will occur despite the effects of the dry season and the El Niño phenomenon. The MWSSS, the level in Angat Dam, is still above the critical level of 180 meters. The public, though, still being urged to conserve water amid hot weather.
Yung ating pong panawagan ay hindi lamang po sa mga residential customers, kasama na rin po itong mga commercial establishments po natin, kasama din po yung mga industrial establishments po natin. So all throughout the customers po ng Maynila, ang ating pong ginagawa ay pagbabawas lamang po ng pressure ng tubig at hindi po mawawalan po ng tubig yung ating pong mga customer. Normal situation po, ang pressure po ng ating tubig, umaabot po yan hanggang sa second floor po ng ating mga bahay. Kapag may air ka po, no? Sa may second floor, umaabot pa po yung tubig. So may tubig pa pong lumalabas. Pero kapag binawasan po yung pressure, mahina na po yung dadaloy na tubig.
Philippine Senator Rafi Tulfo raising a possible conflict of interest against Environment Secretary Tony Yulo Loizaga. Tulfo cited a Philippine Star article of Jarius Bondoc claiming the Environment Secretary's family owns about 40,000 hectares of land in the towns of Coron and Busuanga in Palawan, called the Yulo King Ranch. Now, those lands had been declared as a pasture reserve back in 1975, but Bondoc claims the Yulos obtained the property just a year later, calling it the largest agrarian anomaly. Tulfo has filed a resolution to investigate the matter. He also plans to invite Palawan farmers who are seeking the distribution of a small portion of the property to them. We're still trying to reach out to Secretary Yulo Loizaga for her side on the issue. Moving on, the manhunt for fugitive televangelist Apollo Quiboloy extends outside of Davao after law enforcers failed to find him in his known addresses in the city. Raya Capulong reports.
The Philippine National Police continues to pursue Kingdom of Jesus Christ founder and leader Pastor Apollo Quiboloy. According to PNP PIO Acting Chief and Spokesperson Colonel Gene Fajardo, the Davao PNP also tried to serve the arrest warrant at Quiboloy's prayer mountain, but he was not there.
Negative po yung naging result po ng pag-service po ng warrants of arrest dahil wala po doon sa prayer mountain. Just kanina lang po, I was informed by the regional director na sumuko na rin po yung dalawa pa na naiiwan na tatlo. Dalawang babae po yung sumuko ngayon. So ang ina-account na lang po natin as of today po ay si Pastor Quiboloy na lamang po.
Two more individuals who are co-accused together with Quiboloy for child abuse case have surrendered to the National Bureau of Investigation, Southeastern Mindanao Region on Thursday morning. However, both Jacqueline Roy and Ingrid Canada, who are members of Kingdom of Jesus Christ, immediately posted bail at the Davao City Hall of Justice on Thursday noon.
Because when they knew that they have already a warrant of arrest and they don't want that they will hide all the time while nakapende itong kaso. So they turned to us.
The NBA said they have visited Quiboloy's possible hideouts to serve the warrants of arrest, including the Kingdom of Jesus Christ compound in Buhangin District, Garden of Eden Restored Prayer Mountain in Barangay Tamayong, and about 6 to 7 properties of Quiboloy in the island garden city of Samal. Even the arrested members claim they don't know the whereabouts of the controversial church leader.
We are not sure that he's still here in Davao, but we are pretty sure that he's still here in the Philippines, no? Kasi based sa record ng immigration, hindi siya lumabas ng country. Ang sabi nila this time, itong dalawang nahuli natin na nag-surrender, for past few days, hindi na nila nakikita at nakakausap.
But Police Regional Office 11 Director Police Brigadier General Alden Delvo believes Quiboloy is still in Davao.
So, sa akin lang, kutob yun, because if I were him, Davao City is a safe haven.
When asked if there's a possibility Quiboloy could be staying with the administrator of his properties, former President Rodrigo Duterte, Delvo had this to say.
There is a probability, of course, kung makita ko si former president, which is nandito lang naman sa Davao, probably in just... bakit hindi natin pwedeng maitanong?
Hindi niyo pwedeng puntahan para talaga tanong?
Hindi rin natin alam. Let's give him his space and privacy. He is our former president.
Ah, no? So you give him that kind of treatment then?
Kung pupuntahan natin sila, kailangan natin na yung formal naman na i-request natin. He's just an ordinary guy also. He's our former president. So hindi natin yung pwedeng katukin lang natin sa bahay. Kailangan naman na pupuntahan at tatanungin po.
So pwede po apuntahan.
Pero hindi agad-agad.
Pwede naman ganon.
The PNP tracker team will expand the search for Quiboloy beyond the Davao area. The PNP warns those sheltering Quiboloy, they could also face charges.
We want to appeal for those taking care. Kaya nagkakanlong po o nag-accommodate po kay Pastor Quiboloy. Ang pinagkaiba po nito sa warrants of arrest na inisyo po ng Senate ay maaari po kayong maharap sa kaso kung sakasakaling mapapatunayan po na nagkakanlong po kayo ng isa pong tao. Hindi lamang po ito limited kay Pastor Quiboloy na kaso. Ang isang tao po o sino mang individual na magkakanlong sa isang taong pinaghahanap po ng batas ay maaari po kayong mapaila ng kaso po harboring a wanted person.
The PNP is calling on Quiboloy to surrender while also appealing to his supporters to remain calm. Aside from the arrest warrant issued by the Davao Regional Trial Court few days ago, the Senate also has standing arrest order for Quiboloy for refusing to face the Committee on Women, Children, Family Relations and Gender Equalities investigation on his alleged abuses of his followers.
Dapat galangin niya ang proseso at warrant ngayon means that ito ay formal court na pwede siyang ipaliwanag niya doon sa formal court, pwede niyang depensahan yung sarili niya at pwede niya ring ipaliwanag yung kanyang side, no? Dahil narinig ko, sinasabi nila na ang Senate at Congress hindi naman formal court.
Raya Kapulong, ABS-CBN News.
The Philippine High Court affirms the amnesty granted to former mutineer-turned-senator Antonio Trillanes. It struck down a proclamation by then-President Rodrigo Duterte, which scrapped the amnesty given by his predecessor. Adrian Ayalin reports.
It was in 2003 when a then-young military officer, Antonio Trillanes, joined the Oakwood Mutiny against then-President Gloria Macapagal Arroyo. In 2007, already a sitting senator, Trillanes also figured in the Peninsula Manila Hotel siege to call for the ouster of Arroyo. In 2010, Trillanes was granted amnesty by then-President Noynoy Aquino, only to be revoked in 2018 by then-President Rodrigo Duterte through a presidential proclamation. But on April 3, 2024, the Supreme Court en banc released its ruling while in the middle of its summer session in Baguio City. The Supreme Court declared that the amnesty granted to Trillanes is valid and the action of Duterte to revoke the amnesty is unconstitutional. In the decision penned by Associate Justice Maria Filomena Singh, a president cannot revoke the grant of amnesty without concurrence from Congress. The High Court also stressed the primacy of the Bill of Rights as it reaffirmed that neither the government nor any of its officials, including the president, are above the law. The court also said the attempt to revive the criminal cases against Trillanes, which had been dismissed with finality, violated his constitutional rights against double jeopardy. The court also noted that Trillanes actually filed his amnesty application. In Proclamation No. 572, signed by then-Executive Secretary Salvador Medialdea for President Duterte, there was no available copy of the application. But Trillanes said his application was widely covered by the media, and just like a driver's license, his certificate of amnesty is all that matters.
Nung nag-file ako ng aking application, covered ng media, no? Yan, TV Patrol, lahat, national media, pinakita ko sa ano yung application form. At well-documented, no? Pero naghahanap nga sila ng butas, no? Naghahanap sila ng pwede ikaso.
Trillanes said he may initiate legal moves for violations of his constitutional rights, but at the appropriate time. For now, Trillanes thanks the independence being shown by the judiciary.
Dahil itinaguyod nila kung ano yung tama, at tayo rin ay masaya at under the Marcos administration ay nagkakaroon ng democratic space.
In a statement, former Senator Laila De Lima also lauded the Supreme Court decision, as she stressed that former President Duterte's acts were politically motivated and were manifestations of his vengeful dispositions. ABS-CBN reached out to former Duterte administration officials, but they have yet to issue a statement.
The Supreme Court wants to emphasize that in the delicate balancing of presidential prerogative on the one hand and citizens' rights on the other, the Constitution and the laws must prevail, not the whims and desires of any individual. Adrian Ayalin, ABS-CBN News.
Now, the High Court has ruled that even persons serving time for heinous crimes are entitled to jail term reductions. In its decision, the Supreme Court said the Justice Department erred when it excluded such convicts from earning Good Conduct Time Allowance or GCTA. The High Court argues all prisoners can avail of the benefits of the GCTA law. The Duterte administration revised the implementing rules and regulations of the GCTA law back in 2019 after a public uproar over the possible release of convicted murderer and rapist Antonio Sanchez. His case highlighted controversies including possible corruption in the granting of jail term reductions. Now let's get a reaction on this Supreme Court decision. We're joined now by Arsenio Boy Evangelista. He's the president of the Volunteers Against Crime and Corruption. Mr. Evangelista, welcome to Dateline Philippines. Thank you so much for talking to us.
Okay, good afternoon, Stanley. Greetings of peace, justice, and truth from Volunteers Against Crime and Corruption.
Okay, first, the big story here. Persons convicted of heinous crimes now also entitled to prison sentence reductions or good conduct time allowance. Sir, is this fair and acceptable?
Stanley, today is a sad day for all victims of injustice, for victims of heinous crimes, and all major crimes. It is the Supreme Court decision is a bittersweet decision. It is bitter for all of us victims of heinous crime and sweet for all those convicted criminals. So I think this decision is more of pro-criminal,
okay,
and not pro-victims like us. So while we respect the Supreme Court decision, but then we have we must move backwards when during that 2019 I attended the Senate hearing, Blue Ribbon of Senator Gordon. That is the good conduct time allowance. I attended 9 public hearings. We submitted a VACC position paper, also other civil society groups, all legal bright minds, that if your service of sentence is 40 years or reclusion perpetua in the absence of death penalty, you cannot even avail of a single second, a minute of credit from that particular law that was crafted, sponsored by no less than Senator Miriam Defensor. That's what I remember.
All right. Now, Mr. Evangelista, now, you know, reform said to be one of the pillars of the penal system, which may have been the basis of some of the courts or some of these opinions to offer or allow GCTA for typical offenders. But for perpetrators of heinous crimes, what to you makes their case different?
Still, you know, in my case, I it was a 12-year journey, you know, to get this conviction. Mm-hmm. It was decided, promulgated last March, only last March, last year. This decision is sending a very wrong message. It will, for victims like us, up to this time, we are still grieving, crying, and we are still psychologically affected, no, by what happened. Then all of a sudden, these convicted felons will be given opportunity once again. Now my question to the Supreme Court, are these felons ready to mingle with us? Those who killed my son, shot in the head, burned my son beyond recognition, those criminals who raped minors, series of killings, a massacre. Do you think the Supreme Court has the reasons that these criminals can again be free and mingle with society? So that's a big question. Also, time credit. You know, yung culture of impunity and culture of corruption within all those agencies and system. I remember that 2019, halos lahat ng credits were given. I remember 1,912 PDLs were given, even given that time credit. Nakalabas po sila, including that most celebrated case, the pending release of Mayor Sanchez. No? He was sentenced for 160 plus years. Then for the killing of Aileen Sarmenta and the rape of Aileen and Gomez. So okay. I think this is not for a good decision for the Filipino people, especially for those big victims who are really trying, fighting it out 12 years in spite of all the dangers, psychological depression. And me personally, I lost my business. And my threats, no, I'm getting threats from these well-organized crime groups, which is also known as the Dominguez Carnapping Group. Just so we would say this milestone decision, I would say, is not it's a sad decision for all of us victims, and also the only time we victims can move forward is if we get that kind that conviction. Right. In the absence of death penalty, pumayag na nga kami kahit walang death penalty, no? Masyadong unfair sa victims ng mga heinous crimes.
I understand, because in that sense, the victims would feel that they got justice. Now, this, of course, development is upon us. What are you most worried about this? I mean, are you seeing scenarios like the release of mass murderers such as the ASG, or even the Ampatuans and those connected with other criminal syndicates moving forward. Is that a fear?
Yes, that's number one. You know, ready ba sila to blend with us, to be with us sa outside world? Secondly, those witnesses, who witnesses for the conviction, who stand up, yung mga tumayo, now I fear for my life. Because the moment makalabas sila outside of that commitment centers, they can somehow, they can regroup, especially the local terrorists. Again, they can regroup. Those well-organized crime groups can regroup, hire players, and threaten us. And also, because especially me, no, ako masyado akong vocal, I'm the one standing for truth. I am the spokesperson, guardians of truth. So yung threat level ko is mas mataas. Also, yung mga victims who fought it out for the conviction of these criminals.
Okay, Mr. Evangelista, do you think this system is prone to abuse? I mean, what are your reservations now about, this being handled by less competent authorities? Maybe corruption can be evolved or involved, and maybe, some of these convicts may use some advantage or some favors or give some favors in exchange for a GCTA benefit.
Correct. This is really subject for abuse. We remember the reason why we had that Senate public hearing, because of the culture of corruption inside the New Bilibid. Mm-hmm. Number one, inside the New Bilibid, everything there is free, no? Free for the use of cell phones, free to enter prostitution, ano? Na doon yung prostitution, na doon yung VIP treatment. Even 1PDL is having a concept there inside, having interviews. So the culture of corruption inside the commitment centers is there, no? Present. So these PDLs will surely, because of their good lawyers, surely they can play with that law. They can even fast track the credits, the good conduct time allowance credits, like what happened, no, for that 1,912 PDLs who were granted, who benefited with that law. Yun ang nakikita namin dito. So it is subject to abuse, and also yung culture nga ng ng corruption within these agencies for the longest time, since time immemorial, nandiyan yan, yung New Bilibid prison na yan.
Okay, Mr. Evangelista, we know you're still processing this development. I'm sure a lot of the victims are also thinking about the repercussions or the implications of this Supreme Court decision. Now, if the penal system, though, and the courts are going in this direction, what measures do you think must be in place to make sure GCTA is not abused? What do you wish to see in terms of how this will be done?
They should have a very airtight coordination, the synergy to coordinate with DOJ as the implementing agency, with the Bucor personnels. Especially yung time credit allowance should be mabantayan, talagang yung deserving na ready for reformation, those credits na really tailored fit for them, for their release. Dapat yun talaga mabantayan at lahat. Yung pag-earn ng credit should be proper.
All right, lastly, and before we go, this is already to be implemented, but are there plans on the part of your group, Volunteers Against Crime and Corruption, to amplify your opposition to this move?
Well, ang BACC can only do much, no? Maybe we can make a position paper telling it's unfair for victims in the absence of death penalty. The only time we can get that retribution is if we see them inside the jail. those position proposals will only be proposals, no? But then I think this is the Supreme Court, so the order or the revision of this law is supreme. But then at least on TV, on national media, we can say our position, mm-hmm. as victims, that I think this is so unfair, this is pro-criminal, and unfair in the sense that in my case, or most of us are fighting it out, support for 10 years, 12 years, yeah. 15 years, then at the end of the day, then you see these criminals walking out of prison just simply because of good time, yes. Allowance, yeah, credit.
You know, Mr. Evangelista, another way of pushing resistance to this is, of course, pushing or campaigning for the return of the death penalty. How do you feel about that?
Yes, ever since DACC is embracing the return of death penalty, first, it is a deterrent, and the certainty of death will deter criminals or would-be criminals in committing serious crimes, especially illegal drugs, and also plunder should be included there. For us, because plunder is the mother of all crimes. But then I know it will have a lot of opposition for those lawmakers, no? Both houses. Mm-hmm. And death penalty is it is a fear factor. Certainty of death for criminals will deter you. Human instinct will tell you that if there is death, certain death, you will think twice, thrice, many times before committing. So since the absence of death penalty, yun na nga lang ang just consolation na lang nga namin is to see them there. Well, dumaan sila sa proseso. All the rights were given to them, the right to get a counsel, the right to make MR, motion for reconsideration. Right. Mm-hmm. Yes, but one is certain, the victim is 6 feet below the ground, no right at all. So it is for us to talk in their behalf, to somehow get the justice they truly deserve.
All right, Mr. Arsenio Boy Evangelista, President of Volunteers Against Crime and Corruption. Thank you so much for this conversation today. Have a good day.
Okay, thank you, Stanley. Mabuhay po kayo.
All right, up next, deaths linked to rabies on the rise. The details when Dateline Philippines returns. Stay with us. Welcome back. The Philippine government ramping up efforts to counter false narratives on the West Philippine Sea. The Philippine Coast Guard has partnered with the Public Information Agency to conduct workshops on information officers across the country. It is also working with tech platforms to take down websites or social media pages spreading fake information on the issue. Since last year, Manila has been exposing China's harassment through information releases and inviting journalists to join resupply missions to the Ayungin Shoal.
We're not actually escalating the tension. We're not provoking anybody. We do not provoke the People's Republic of China. What we are doing in Ayungin Shoal is just a routine and legitimate operation of the armed forces of the Philippines, supported by the Philippine Coast Guard.
There's a lot of contradicting narratives, fake news, disinformation, missing the Philippine Information Agency is here to assert in truth and facts and reality on the ground.
Expect heavier traffic along EDSA and other parts of Metro Manila in the coming days and months. That's because the Public Works and Highways Department is set to start several major roadworks in the metro. The DPWH will conduct retrofitting activities along the southbound lane of the Kamuning flyover in Quezon City by the end of this month to make it more resilient to tremors. The project will take 11 months or until the first quarter of next year. The agency assures there will be no full closure of the flyover to prevent heavy traffic. It adds the capital region's bus rapid transit system. The EDSA bus carousel will not be affected. The agency will also start reblocking projects in different parts of the metropolis starting at 11 this evening. The affected areas are flashed on your screen. The Philippine Statistics Office recently opened the Philippine ID system registration to Filipino children aged 1 to 4. Jackie Pascual walks us through the process.
The Philippine Statistics Authority urges parents to register their young kids for the Philippine Identification System or PhilSIS. The agency has opened the registration to 1 to 4-year-olds in a bid to allow more citizens to get their national ID. The only requirements are a birth certificate for the child and the parent must already be registered. The PSA says it is important to register the children because it would be easier for them to transact with government in the future.
Health benefits, no, na mas madali siya na kung registered siya sa PhilSIS, moving forward na mag-enroll siya sa eskwelahan, if the ped will eventually have use cases regarding the use of the national ID and the learner's record, mas madali na siya.
To encourage parents to register their children, PSA is going around daycare centers like this one in Malabon.
Habang bata pa lang sila, no, sa early age nila po, meron na silang valid ID. Malaking birth certificate, no, tsaka mas okay yun kasi medyo hindi na hassle yung pagdadala nila ng mga school IDs.
Habang bata pa kami, pagkakilala na once na mawala, meron na po siyang ID.
So far, there are 220,000 1 to 4-year-olds registered with PhilSIS, which is why the PSA is also looking to motivate teens and more adults to register as well.
Dapat magpa-register na kayo and sooner or later, makita natin yung benefit of being registered sa PhilSIS pag na-integrate na yung mga processes ng government natin sa PhilSIS.
Soliesta assures parents the personal information of their children are handled securely. They will continue to have registration desks set up in daycare centers and malls to attract more Filipinos to get their Philippine ID number. Jackie Pascual, ABS-CBN News.
The Philippine Health Department sounds the alarm over the rising number of deaths linked to rabies since the start of the year. The details from Izzy Lee.
John Ray went to an animal bite center to receive an anti-rabies vaccine after being scratched by his pet cat on Wednesday night.
Pumunta ako dun sa main gate namin para isara. So, nung pagbalik ko dun para kunin yung tali niya, bigla na lang niya ako inatake at kinalmot.
According to a veterinarian from the Bureau of Animal Industry, rabies cases usually increase during the summer season.
Historically, yung mga ating past data, mas mataas ang cases ng mga bite cases kapag summer. That is because madalas yung mga bata nasa labas naglalaro, so mas mataas yung mga biting incidents.
According to experts, the case fatality rate for rabies is 100% if left untreated. According to the data of the Department of Health, more than 80 people have died from rabies in the Philippines from January until March 16 this year.
Hugasan natin yung sugat. Ideally with running water and soap for mga 10 to 15 minutes. After the first course of action na washing the wound with soap, running water and soap, pumunta immediately tayo sa mga animal bite treatment centers.
The anti-rabies vaccine is available for free at DOH animal bite centers. Experts remind that the rabies virus can be transmitted through scratches and bites from dogs or cats, but it can also be transmitted among other animals. In Marinduque, two towns have been placed under state of calamity after rabies cases rose in the area.
Itong mga nagkaroon ng rabies ay yung mga baka at baboy na nakagat ng aso dito sa Marinduque. Ito naman ay na-contain, napatay na yung mga baka.
A according to Ordinaryo, it is the responsibility of pet owners to have their cats and dogs vaccinated by licensed veterinarians once a year. The Department of Agriculture plans to allocate funds in its 2025 budget to vaccinate more than 20 million dogs in the country against rabies. Easily, ABS-CBN News.
World news now, a fourth Filipino has been injured in the powerful quake that rocked Taiwan Wednesday. The Philippine Migrant Workers Department said the OFW sustained minor injuries and has been discharged. Only one of the four Filipinos injured remains in hospital. Meanwhile, the search continues for 18 still missing in the aftermath of the quake. 10 people are confirmed to have been killed, while over 1,000 were hurt. The U.S. wielding its power and influence over Israel. U.S. President Joe Biden threatening to condition support for Israel's offensive in Gaza to force Tel Aviv to ramp up protection for aid workers and civilians. The White House said Biden and Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu spoke on the phone with the American leader, calling the recent deadly attack on aid workers and the overall humanitarian situation in Gaza unacceptable. Biden made clear U.S. policy will change if Israel fails to implement concrete steps to minimize harm on civilians. This marks the first time the U.S. tried to leverage aid to influence Israel's military behavior. Washington's top diplomat also saying an immediate truce is needed.
Here's the current reality in Gaza. Despite important steps that Israel's taken to allow assistance into Gaza, the results on the ground are woefully insufficient and unacceptable. 100% of the population in Gaza knows acute levels of food insecurity. 100% of the population is in need of humanitarian assistance. And those working heroically to provide that assistance are doing so in great peril to their own lives. This week's horrific attack on the World Central Kitchen was not the first such incident. It must be the last. And with regard to our policy in Gaza, look, I'll just say this. If we don't see the changes that we need to see, there'll be changes in our own policy.
This week's killing of 7 aid workers from the World Central Kitchen drew international condemnation. With no let-up with Israel's offensives, the casualties in Gaza also continues to soar, with the death toll breaching 33,000. Israel, meanwhile, vows to adjust its tactics in the six-month-old war following the killing of aid workers. Israel's military earlier called the deadly airstrike an operational accident. A spokesperson for Israel's government also insists the attack was unintended after World Central Kitchen founder Chef Jose Andres accused Israel of deliberately targeting his team.
That it was a mistake that followed a misidentification at night in very complex war conditions. But we are conducting a thorough and transparent examination of this case through the fact-finding assessment mechanism, an independent expert body. In the coming weeks, as the findings become clear, we will be transparent and share the results with the public. So clearly something went wrong here. And as we learn more and the investigation reveals exactly what happened and the cause of what happened, we will certainly adjust our practices in the future to make sure that this doesn't happen again.
Nearly 200 humanitarian workers have been killed in Gaza since October, according to the United Nations. A Hamas official pinning the blame on Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu for the lack of progress in Gaza ceasefire talks. Osama Hamdan says Netanyahu has been placing obstacles hindering both parties from reaching an agreement, despite Hamas showing flexibility. Egyptian and Qatari efforts backed by the U.S. have so far failed to achieve a ceasefire, while Hamas wants any agreement to secure an end to the Israeli military offensive. Israel prefers a prisoners or hostage release deal, refusing to commit to ending its military campaign. Over in Yemen, 37 people have been killed in airstrikes by the U.S. and the U.K. on Houthi targets. These airstrikes are in retaliation for the Houthi group's attacks on ships passing through the Red Sea, which the rebels claim as sympathy attacks for Palestinians. The leader of the Houthis also revealed it has targeted a total of 90 ships in the Red Sea. The group also claims the U.S. and Britain had failed to prevent or limit their attacks on global shipping. Over in the U.S., Los Angeles police and the Federal Bureau of Investigation probing one of the largest cash thefts in the city's history. Burglars broke through the roof of a money storage facility and cracked a safe on Easter Sunday, carrying out a daring heist with a haul of nearly $30 million. The Los Angeles Times reports the elaborate and complex theft appeared to be the work of an experienced crew who were able to evade the building's sophisticated alarm systems. The massive theft was not discovered until Monday morning. Researchers are wiring up coffee plants with solar-powered sensors in Tanzania in a bid to understand how climate change affects them. Take a look.
How can you tell if a coffee plant is suffering from the effects of climate change? Just listen to it. That's the hope of researchers who are wiring up coffee plants with solar-powered sensors in Tanzania.
The idea is to have this technology attached to some plants that will be our like the voice of the plantations.
At Utengule Coffee Farm, researchers are monitoring 20 Arabica coffee plants that are wired up across the plantation. Each plant is attached to electrodes that monitor it. Using Internet of Things technology developed by Cisco, these wired plants will provide researchers with continuous updates on their health and hydration. The project is being run by the Italian espresso research center, Accademia del Caffè Espresso, alongside PNAT, a think tank of designers and plant scientists. Camilla Pandolfi is the CEO of PNAT.
This technology aims to record and decode plants' electrical activities to understand whether we can help with the management of water or other agricultural practices. At the moment, we are training our machine learning algorithms, and then we will set in place an AI that will automatically train and tell us when we need to intervene on the plantation.
Tanzania, a major coffee producer, is already feeling the effects of climate change with unpredictable rainfall and extended droughts. Hans Faisler is the owner of Utengule Coffee Farm.
I see a particular acceleration in the last few years. I would say the last 5 to 10 years, I would say. I saw suddenly an acceleration of competition for the water. On one hand, competition for the water, but also less water flow in the river, the double effect.
The Wired Up Coffee Plants project in Tanzania is the first time sensor-based technology has been deployed in a coffee plantation, according to researchers at the Accademia del Caffè Espresso. They hope information gathered from the Wired Up Coffee Plants and their surroundings could potentially benefit not only coffee growers around the world, but farmers of other crops who are trying to counter the effects of climate change.
And before we go, Muhammad Ali's white satin boxing trunks from his epic Thriller in Manila fight with Joe Frazier, now up for auction. Sotheby's estimates the value to be between $4 to $6 million. The historic piece of sport memorabilia hits the auction block on April 12. The 1975 bout in the Philippines marked the end of one of the greatest trilogies in boxing history. Ali retained the heavyweight crown in the iconic slugfest when Frazier's trainer barred him from answering the bell for the 15th round. And that'll do it for today. Thanks a lot for joining us. I'm Stanley Palisada. If you want to revisit today's episode, you can play back this newscast on the YouTube channel of ABS-CBN News and on ANC 24/7 on Facebook. Keep safe, everyone, as you keep it here on the news channel.